Right. Okay. Thanks, everybody. I'm Dave Tucker from a little company called Socketplane. We are actually developing applications on top of Open vSwitch. So this is kind of a user's perspective on why Open vSwitch is so great and why we believe that it would be a really good fit for Docker. So let's just see, does everybody know what Docker is? Show of hands, who's heard of Docker? Right, good, okay. Nobody's been like locked in the cave for the last year or so and hasn't heard of it. So Docker is obviously gonna be the next big thing in compute. And there's already work ongoing to integrate Open vSwitch and Docker. So we've got some work in OVS that's already been merged. So you can head into OVS and read install.docker. There's a script there that allows you to hook up Docker containers using Open vSwitch, which is cool. There's also a project on GitHub called Pipework, which allows you to spin up containers with no network and then insert your Open vSwitch-powered network, which is also cool. And we have some proposals in place in Docker to actually get some native integration, which means no messing around with external tools and scripting. You can just deploy Docker and your network will be Open vSwitch powered. So that's where we stand today. But we just wanted to kind of highlight why we're concerned with Docker networking today and why we want to change it and why we believe Docker is so awesome, just to kind of cover those two points there. So first of all, I'll cover why Docker's great. So the reason we love Docker so much is because we can have an application package with its dependencies. So anybody here written a spec file? Built on RPM, right? Or package something for Debian. It's a headache. It takes you weeks. With Docker, it's really cool. I found Docker files, and I was like, wow, this is excellent. I can even package Open vSwitch and run it in Docker. It's really, really simple to package something and have it in a format which I can deploy onto anything. I don't care if it's Ubuntu anymore. I don't care if it's Fedora. I just say, here you go, Mr. Customer. Here's your application. Just Docker pull, and away you go. And we really, really like that lightweight approach. The only thing that concerns us a little bit is the networking stack in Docker today, which is all based around Linux Bridge. And we know how well that worked for OpenStack. You know, as Guido said at the very beginning of the day, Open vSwitch is the number one plugin for OpenStack for lots of reasons, you know. And those are performance, scale, reliability, manageability, and a made-up word, which is DevOpsability. So we'll cover each of these in depth, but performance definitely is good, especially since 2.1, we're seeing really great performance in OVS. Scale, we've got the OpenStack reference there. It's number one deployed in OpenStack. Reliability also comes from OpenStack. Manageability, OVSDB, we've got a talk on that tomorrow about some of the work we've been doing in OVSDB. And DevOpsability, which is a little bit of a strange one, but as a networking guy, I used to do a lot of work on Cisco boxes, I used to do a lot of work on HP boxes, on lots of different various boxes from other vendors. And no switching solution today has had as rich a tool set as Open vSwitch. It's great. I can pull information about the flow tables. I can pull information about configuration state. It's really easy to use. It's really easy to script. Very easy to automate. And those are really important things for us as network ops guys as we're moving into this transition of whatever the next generation is going to be, that whatever solution that we have in something like Docker is going to be compatible with these type of cool tools that we've all got used to. So on performance, I mean, the guys from Rackspace summed it up when they said that OVS 2.1 was ludicrous speed. And as we start to see things like DPDK coming along, hardware offload for VXLAN, other types of hardware offload, we're gonna see Open vSwitch really heading into new ground in terms of performance, which, you know, is absolutely perfect in environments where we see changes in data center traffic. So everybody's seen Facebook's blog post about their data center architecture and people talking about how the shift in traffic has moved from north-south to east-west. So then the performance between containers or VMs on a single switch becomes very important. And that's why having something like Open vSwitch is, again, very important. So just to a little bit of a comparison, now, this is up on GitHub if you want to pull it and try it for yourself. The numbers are pretty small, so apologize for people squinting. But we did a little performance comparison just to see how things compared. So we had a look at Linux Bridge. We had a look at Open vSwitch using vPairs. We had a look at Mac VLAN and Mac VLAN-based bridging, and we had a look at Open vSwitch with internal ports. And right there at the top is Open vSwitch with internal ports. It's by far the most performance solution without acceleration for doing connections within the same virtual machine or Docker host. Anything using vEth pairs is pretty awful, and Mac VLAN was kind of between the two. So if you want to pull that, I'll send some links to the project on GitHub so you can have a play. This was only done on my laptop, so the performance figures aren't exactly reliable. We'd be able to do this on some bare metal, actually see some proper results. Has anybody heard of a solution called Weave for multi-host networking in Docker? A couple of people? Okay. So we've been doing networking in open daylight. We've deployed VXLAN for OpenStack. So we were just interested to see what the difference is between Open vSwitch using VXLAN and Weave. So Weave uses PCAP, grabs the packet off the wire, switches it over to a router, switches it back out again, and this is just Open vSwitch with VXLAN tunnels. And there is a massive performance difference, again, without any acceleration at all. In terms of megabits per second, we're seeing an average of about 90 megabits per second for Weave, and OVS with VXLAN at 500. Again, this was on a virtual machine with absolutely no acceleration, and I'm pretty sure if you threw a VXLAN offload-capable NIC at this, then those performance figures would be through the roof. So again, these are the reasons why we love Open vSwitch. Now, for benefits for the user in Docker, one of the very cool things about using VXLAN and using Open vSwitch is that we can have a coherent network virtualization story across all of our things. So whether we want to have a OpenStack environment with VXLAN, which again, the most popular plugin there, we can have the same thing in Docker and we can join the two together. So if you want to migrate workloads or have some containers talking to some VMs, yeah, we can do that. We've had hardware VTEP support in Open vSwitch for a while now. So that means we can plug into our bare metal workloads as well. And at that point, things are starting to get simple again. It doesn't mean that we need to have pockets of network all over the place using various different encapsulations, and we can actually perform some standardization. And getting a standardized virtual edge, having Open vSwitch on all of our edge would be awesome. Again, we have the tooling now to have a DevOps capable network and to actually do some reasonable automation without having the fragility of running expect scripts on Cisco boxes. So this is Docker networking today. Just a switch, a bridge, randomly assigned IP addresses. This is pretty simple stuff, and NAT in the front end. Of course, with the work that's going on in Open vSwitch with Contract and NAT, this is totally something that we can actually pull inside Open vSwitch in its totality, and then not have to worry about managing IP tables anymore, which from an ops side is pretty cool because now I only have one place to look and the Open vSwitch tools are really good. We can also start to think about improving Docker networking to include things like IP address management. So you can actually have a sane IP addressing scheme now for your containers, one that maps to your existing environment, which then allows you to do the type of integration we were talking about, having a VXLAN stretch from a physical device into your Docker network, or from your Docker network into your OpenStack network. We can also do some routing functionality as well, distributed virtual routing. This is something that we proved out in open daylight. We can do op responder at the edge. We've actually managed to turn Open vSwitch into a reasonable router, with the only thing missing there was ICMP support. So that's something that we're looking at different ways of approaching. But again, the type of things that we can do with Open vSwitch are very cool. And having that API, the flow programming language to do it with, again, has worked very well for this. So this is just an extension of the previous, but now including VXLAN. And we could even do something very cool and crazy if we were to add a routing protocol on top of Open vSwitch and turn it into a router, then there's no reason why we couldn't peer with Facebook's crazy BGP network and actually advertise reachability directly from the container host or the OpenStack host into the underlay. So these are all very cool things we can do with Open vSwitch. So what would be the benefit of Open vSwitch from the Docker integration? Well, The thing that we see here is broader adoption of Open vSwitch, extending Open vSwitch into a wider user base. So we've actually started to have discussions with people in the Docker community about, should we bring in Open vSwitch or not? And the thing that we hear is Open vSwitch is heavy and Open vSwitch is complex. We're like, no, it's not. You've seen Linux Bridge, like brkettle. I mean, it's just apples to apples. Like brkettle, OVS kettle, it's really no different. It scares people. And I think that hopefully bringing in some of these systems people, the guys that are currently working on Docker and bringing them into the Open vSwitch community would be very positive for both parties. We'll start to get some new requirements into Open vSwitch and some perspectives from some DevOps-like folks to see whether the tooling that we've got is good enough and whether we can improve it. And that's me. So I appreciate that I'm between you guys and beer and robots, so if there's questions, let's do them.
Hi, Chandra from AVI Networks. If you go back to previous slides where you interconnect the host over the VXLAN or with the regular networking, some of the assumptions are essentially the container exposes only one network. Is it possible to expose multiple networks within one container?
It's not something that we've thought about right away, but I don't see why it wouldn't be possible.
Today the IP address management, especially the private IP, is done by the Docker daemon. So there is initial pipe work. You can do some of these things with the native Linux commands, but there's no automated way to have unique IP and all the sorts of network orchestration to be done. So it would be good to have that coming all the way to the container. So you have the flexibility of the VM, like VM, to support multiple networks within the container.
Yeah, absolutely. So, I mean, I'll link you guys to the proposals that we've put out into the Docker community, but our call to action would be, if you guys have requirements, or you have ideas, or you have ways that you would like to see Open vSwitch integrated, to come into the discussion and let us know. Because we see Pipeworks as a really great thing, but the only thing is, nobody's going to deploy Docker in production with an external tool that needs to be called in order to do the networking. There's the expectation is that it should be integrated. So, hope that answers your question, sorry.
Hi, this is Flavio from Reddit. Could you comment a little bit more about the testing you did with Linux Bridge and OVS?
Sure. Let me just go back to that slide. Okay. So the test environment was pretty simple. Essentially, the test was to spin up two network namespaces connected to a bridge, and that bridge was either Linux bridge, Mac VLAN, OVS with VEth, and then simply run IPath between them. So very rough, ready test, not in any means scientific, but yielded some interesting performance figures.
Okay, because I did similar test with OVS and Linux Bridge, but not using VMs, using directly hardware. And what I found is pretty much the same difference you did there. But if you profile the Linux Bridge, you'll see that the major cost, that major difference there is caused by the iptables hooks. And this is also a difference that it's important to highlight this because OVS is not integrated with iptables. So to compare apples to apples, you would have to disable those hooks. If you do that, Linux Bridge will perform pretty much as OVS there. Unless you, I'm not really sure how you connect the VMs to the OVS. Maybe that does a difference.
Yeah, so we did with, we connected the VMs to OVS using internal ports for the very top line there, and via V for the very bottom there, which was, pretty similar to Linux Bridge in that regard. But you know, your point about IP tables is very valid. And I think that as we kind of look to the work that Thomas and Justin are doing with Contract and pulling that in, that actually allows us to bring some of the stuff that we would have had in IP tables into Open vSwitch's domain. And then at that point, as we saw, you know, with a large number of rules, the performance in Open vSwitch is better than Linux Bridge. or at least that was my takeaway from the presentation. So.
And another thing, you were trying to add a very complex networking setup with Docker, and we know that Docker is, it has been so far just for one host. How do you see, it's a big difference, how do you see the project moving forward later on?
Well, that's a big question. So definitely when we started the work with the Docker community, the first thing we wanted to do was just have Open vSwitch as an option, because we think it's important to have choice, and OVS being a great choice, it would seem silly not to offer that, and even offer it by default, because I don't think there's really too much more complexity inherited to the user by swapping out Linux Bridge for OVS, other than IP tables. So with regard to multi-host, that's a bigger question, and really that's one that needs to be directed at Docker, because for us, we need to understand what Docker wants to do, whether they're, because there's proposals coming in for clustering, there's obviously our proposal for multi-host networking, which comes naturally on top of clustering, because you can't have a cluster without considering the networking implications of running across multiple hosts. So I think it really comes down to how Docker and the community decide they want to move forward as to where we see the right solution being. Sorry for like a vague answer there, but.
Thank you.
Hi, this is Chris Moreno with Cisco. So there's a lot of activity around Docker, and I don't want to get into a debate about running Docker inside of virtual machines, but regardless of your opinion of that, there is tremendous work being done in the area of orchestration for containers. And specifically OpenStack is putting tremendous effort around supporting Docker. Now, presuming such an environment exists, doesn't the orchestration system and the networking support that it provides address many of the issues that you're describing here? Does it or doesn't it? It's really, I don't know the answer, so that's really my question. How many of them would be grandfathered in if OpenStack's networking were to be used underneath this in a tenancy model?
That is a valid question, and I think the real answer is I don't know. I think that definitely if we look at how OpenStack's implemented today, that if you want L2 stretch and you want to configure your networks in the same terms that are used in the Neutron API, you know, with those very rigid constructs of network, subnet, port, if that's still meaningful in the container environment, then yeah, there's definitely value from OpenStack. But again, it's another question, is that what people want? And I'm still not sure we're there yet. I'm still not sure there's consensus around, yes, people want to deploy Docker via OpenStack and use OpenStack networking, or whether they actually want to maintain a separate environment for Docker, which uses a different orchestration system. Because there are at least 10 to 15 good orchestration choices for Docker right now, and OpenStack is only one of them.
Hi, this is Eric Dubay from Red Hat, and I just had a philosophical question here. Have you given any thought for enablement outside of Docker? You know, perhaps some of the other orchestration like Kubernetes, for instance, right? I mean, that's got a pretty sane, you know, model for doing applications, right? You know, the idea that multiple containers create a pod, and then, you know, pod is a service, and multiple services are an application, and I think that makes a lot of sense, at least for this model where you're using OVS, and then you're looking at doing multi-node, obviously for a cluster, right? And that's where VXLAN and all those other technologies, I think, really have a great play, whereas sort of Docker right now is sort of this, you know, single instance, single node, doesn't have a lot of these primitives in terms of conceptual, you know, how you build an application. Just kind of wanted to get your thoughts on that.
Yeah, I mean, it's an interesting one. So when I looked at Kubernetes, as a networking guy, I was kind of confused because it violated the sanctity of IP addresses that we've all come to know and love. It's like, no, I'm sorry, but when I deploy this pod, which is this service, it needs to belong in the subnet with all of the other pieces of that service because I've got metal boxes, and I don't want to have to configure a host rule on each one of those metal boxes to say, oh, yeah, now like this IP address and this one, which are from a non-contiguous block, all need the same security policy. It just kind of makes work kind of in the middle of the network until we find a viable solution for disaggregation of those middle boxes. It's kind of a little bit weird. So yeah, definitely OVS could play a part in Kubernetes, and definitely VXLAN can play a part in Kubernetes. But I think until we find a solution for having flexibility of IP addressing, then you know it's not really going to work in some cases. I mean, for a lot of the enterprise use cases that I see where people still stand by that sanctity of IP addressing, that's going to be tricky. But if you want to kind of throw everything away and you know go via the new way of like nobody cares about IP addresses anymore and we can survive with two layers of NAT and it's all good, then you know that's again you know this is still new territory and we're still finding user stories and we're actually finding what the community wants and it's slowly getting there and we're seeing some very cool solutions.
And overlay connecting containers the right technology choice?
Do you want me to say Genevieve, Chris?
You're not putting words in your mouth at all. I'm curious what you're...
Well,
it's a very genuine open question.
Right. And I guess for us, it comes down to a couple of things, which would be adoption right now and support for TEP in hardware. And VXLAN has that, and that enables us to do lots of cool things, like we were saying, from pulling from one environment into the other. But who knows who's going to win the encapsulation wars, and tomorrow we could all say, yeah, let's use generic UDP tunneling, because that's a great idea. I definitely think, though, that VXLAN has the mind share right now, and whether that war has been won, I'm not sure.
Yeah, I was less thinking about the NCAP format and more about the addressing scheme, where you mentioned maybe double NAT and gets even better, and maybe we, you know, is it time to consider going the other direction?
I mean, well,
we're proliferating containers and we have possible wealth of IP addresses in a different address family.
Double NATing scares me. As a network guy, it's like, so which address again? So my address on my container is not the same as the address that's presented from the host, which is not the same as the service IP address. It's just too many layers of indirection to be able to actually operate and troubleshoot a service. So that's why I'm wondering whether it makes sense to have NAT where it makes sense, at that edge of the network where it's like, this space is public, this is now private space, and to have a contiguous addressing scheme that actually makes sense for private services so I can debug and troubleshoot those the same way that I have done. And yeah, I mean, VXLAN offers us some niceties of you know being able to tunnel and being able to have support for L2, which again, there are people that say, well, why do you need L2? Surely we can do everything with L3. And it's, well, yeah, you can, but you know, host routing, I don't think that's really gonna scale. And when you start looking at how to do large clustered deployments without some form of L2, then it becomes pretty tricky, so.
Thanks.
Sorry.
So I'll follow up on that. So with regards, just follow up on what Chris mentioned about multiple, many 10x's containers versus VMs and IP addressing. So how about IPv6? I mean, how would that, do you see any issues changing?
Anybody deploying IPv6 here right now? Okay, anybody deploying it without DNS? I'm a network guy, right? I want to be able to troubleshoot like the problem on that VM there, and you know, IPv6, yeah. It's not a great answer, but it's getting near the end of the day. I'm jet lagged and I need a beer, so.
Yeah, actually, my question is to Chris and maybe you too. So Chris kind of mentioned why are you trying to use VXLAN? So So I was trying to find out, did you have that question about all overlays, or are you just talking about just VXLAN? Are you saying overlay versus non-overlays, or are you just talking about just VXLAN?
I was really just commenting on the fact that the overlay solution is an interesting solution to a problem that we're now making an order of magnitude worse with containers, and maybe it's really time to reflect on what the right technical solutions are, and I'm not totally convinced that an overlay is the right. I mean, overlay is a nebulous term because there's overlays in networking historically forever. But yeah, some form of NCAP, but the question is, as Florian mentioned, is IPv6 direct connectivity a better way to consider doing container-based network connectivity than continuing to build out the overlay structure that we've started with IPv4-based VMs?
Yeah, that's an interesting thing. It's definitely something that we're looking at, as well as IPv4 tunneling over v6 as well, which I've seen people talking about. Yeah, it's still, this is all new territory, and while I think we can definitely get value from VXLAN today, whether it's the right solution longer term, I think we're still going to need to do some research on.
Do we have any more questions? Doesn't look like it. Let's thank our speaker.